Welcome to Data Structures and Algorithms, Unit 1, Lecture 8. In this lecture, let us continue to see more about SPARC statements. Here in this lecture, particularly, we will see about procedures in SPARC. Okay, so as we all know, procedure is a block of statements which is named and can be reused again and again in your code. Okay, so in this algorithm description language, how do we create a procedure? So to define a procedure, we write the keyword procedure followed by name. Okay, the name, this is the name of the procedure, and this is the list of parameters that we need to pass. Okay, let me now we include the set of statements here, and then we end it with the usual end keyword. Okay, so this is the syntax for the procedure, to create a procedure in the SPARC algorithm description language. Now, what is a function and how is it different from a procedure? A procedure is a set or a sequence of statements which is named actually. But a function returns a value. Procedure doesn't return a value. So if I need to define a function, how should I do it? I can use the same set of statements along with a return keyword. So return expression. It can have an expression as an argument, right? So this is a variation of the procedure which is used to define a function, right? So we use a return statement. Now let's say we have created this procedure. How to make a call to this procedure? Then we have to use call. Okay, C-A-L-L. We use the call keyword, and then we provide the name of the procedure. Okay, after the call keyword, we use the name of the procedure, and then followed by the parameter list. It should be same to the one which is defined already. Okay, we have the function call followed by the parameter, right? So here there are many variations for the procedures. As we have already seen in the C language in your previous semesters, you might be able to visualize this. Okay, a procedure can call itself. Let us see some important points about the procedures which are allowed about the procedures. Procedures can call themselves. Okay, what do I mean by this? One procedure, I create an add procedure. Okay, I create an add procedure. Add is a procedure, and the add procedure can also contain another add procedure inside it. So it calls again and again repeatedly itself. So that is allowed. And we have a procedure A which makes a call to B, and this B in turn can call A again. Okay, so this is a recursive procedure, but A can call A, that's one kind of recursion. But here you can see that A calling B and B in turn calling A, this is also again recursion. So recursive procedures are also allowed here. Okay, recursive procedures are also allowed here. Okay, but what is the disadvantage in procedures? They have a severe penalty of execution time. Okay, execution time is a penalty. Execution time. Let me write it clearly. Execution time is a penalty of executing procedures. Okay. Recursive procedures. This is a disadvantage about recursive procedures. Okay. And for efficiency's sake, some of the programs can be easily translated in such a way that recursion is removed to increase the efficiency. Okay, right. Usually, a SPARC program is a collection of one or more procedures. Okay, a SPARC program is usually a collection of one or more procedures. Usually, if we have, so let us say we have A, B, C, D. We have some four procedures. We say this is the main procedure. The first procedure will be your main procedure. Okay, but how are they connected to each other? They are connected to each other by the parameters, by the parameter, okay, parameter list. Okay, one provides the input to the other through the parameterless. They communicate to each other only through the parameters. Right. So, there are two more important functions here in Sparks. So, what are the other functions? The very important functions and the preliminary functions that we usually see in the programming languages is reading and writing. Input and output functions. Okay. Input and output. Okay. How do they happen? They happen using the read keyword and then the write keyword. Sorry, print keyword. So, read keyword, this has a argument list. Okay. You have an argument list for read keyword. Similarly, for the output, to show the output, we have the print keyword. Print argument list. Okay. We don't have a format statement here, right? Please remember, we don't have a format statement here, right? And the next important concept in Sparks that we need to remember is the comment section. Okay, comment section. So, a comment line starts with double slash, forward slash. This is a comment. So, we have a comment section like this. So, we need to use comment wherever it is necessary in Sparks. We can use it as we use it in the programming languages, right? We have a currently executing procedure. If it has to stop, we need to stop a currently executing procedure, then we can use the stop command, S-T-O-P. The stop command can be used, right? Next, let us go on to the multidimensional arrays. So, what are these multidimensional arrays? Let us say an n-dimensional array. Okay. Let us consider an n-dimensional array. An n-dimensional array, right? How to declare an array of that kind? Let us consider the array name as A. Okay. Array name is A. So, L1, this is the lower bound of the first dimension. Okay. Then the upper bound of the first dimension. I have given the lower and upper bound of the first dimension. Now, then we have the lower bound of the second dimension followed by a colon, upper bound of the second dimension. This goes on and we have lower bound of the nth dimension, colon, upper bound of the nth dimension. So, this is how we will declare an n-dimensional array. Right? Thank you. We'll continue in the next lecture.